Telling us about the situation now in the Caribbean. Thank you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Carlos did a good job of presenting many of the issues in the Caribbean as well. But I'm going to try and show you that though Latin America and the Caribbean is bunched together quite often, the epidemics are quite different. And we need to treat them differently, understand the differences, and be able to manage them accordingly. So we all know and have heard that the Caribbean is the second most affected region out of Africa, with a prevalence rate now of about 1.3% compared to Latin America prevalence rate of about 5%. So in all, the Caribbean is having a generalized epidemic, and the general population is significantly affected. When you look at absolute numbers, you can see that when you're talking about close to 2 million infected persons in Latin America, it's only about 310,000 in the entire Caribbean region that are HIV infected. And as we said, 64% know their status, 52% on ARV. But look at the new infection rates, 18,000 new infection. This gives you a per 1,000 incidence rate of about 0.82. This is almost three times the rate in Latin America, and we need to be clear about that. When you look at the Caribbean as a whole, close to half of the patients are in one country, Haiti. 48% of those infected are in Haiti, 22% in Dominican Republic, and Jamaica, 10%, Cuba, Trinidad has a significant amount, and the other many countries add up to just 8%. Of the infected population. So if we can see that if we can target Haiti, Dominican Republic, Jamaica, Cuba, and Trinidad, we have done a significant job in addressing the epidemic. The prevalence rates are also very diverse in the various countries. From Bahamas, with a 3.3% prevalence rate, perhaps the highest in the Caribbean, to Cuba with a 0.4% prevalence rate, Haiti with 2.1% prevalence rate. But keep in mind that the prevalence rates are also very different among men and women. And when you look overall, unlike in some of the Latin American countries where the epidemic is predominantly among vulnerable groups and predominantly among men, in the Caribbean, it's probably closer to half and half. And in Haiti, for example, the prevalence rate among women is higher than the prevalence rate among men. So we have heard about the new infections, basically stagnant over the last few years in the Caribbean, but we are seeing more and more women being infected, though we recognize that the majority of new infections are still among men. And the number of deaths have also declined. So when you look at new infections overall, you've seen that over the last 6 years or so, we have had a stagnant, no change in the new infection rates, and we continue to have significant new infections. We have done a good job in the prevention of mother-to-child transmission, and we're moving towards achieving that target. But in terms of prevention of new infections, we are still not where we need to be, and the implementation of combination prevention interventions still remain below what they need to. Again, this is not uniform. We have had reduction in new infections in Trinidad, Haiti, the Dominican Republic, and Barbados, but we have had increases in new infections in some of the other countries. Among men, Carlos showed this graph, we're seeing where new infections are increasing among men, not just men who have sex with men, but men in the general population. While we are making some progress with new infections among women, and this also has to do with the marked testing in women compared to men. More women are getting tested than men, knowing their status and getting onto treatment than the men. The men are also presenting later and hence are remaining at risk of transmitting for longer periods. We have done well in the prevention of mother-to-child transmission and protecting children, and less than 1,000 new infections among children we had last year in 2016. So when you look at men who have sex with men, this is really a challenging group. And we recognize in the Caribbean that a third of the new infections are in fact coming from this group. But keep in mind also that more than a half of the new infections are coming from within the general population. So when we're proposing and setting our strategies and targets, we have to focus on the vulnerable groups, but we have to remember that the majority of new infections are in fact in the general population, and women are particularly at risk as well. The infection rates are very different in different countries, from a low of 1.25%, and it has to do with the number of studies that have been done. The information in this area is limited because of some of the laws and regulations in the countries that prevent and restrict persons from actually freely declaring their status. So with Jamaica having the highest prevalence rate of 32%, and this has remained over the years in Jamaica, this prevalence rate, despite several interventions and testing and treatment and strategies to address the group. But in fact, the prevalence rate remains because we have not reached the numbers that need to be tested and put on treatment and appropriate interventions provided. And we still have an environment that is not satisfactory, and stigma and discrimination still exist. So we also have high prevalence rate in Trinidad, and we're happy with the announcement just last week that the Buggery Act in Trinidad has been deemed unconstitutional by the Trinidad High Court, and we're hoping with that said we can move forward to have greater access and better interventions in that country, and that other countries will also follow suit. We have made progress with commercial sex workers, although this is also illegal. It's more acceptable than men who have sex with men, and the testing rates are a bit higher in female sex workers. And so we have seen marked reductions in the prevalence rate among female sex workers in the countries, with Haiti now having perhaps the highest rate in the region. But we have seen rates, for example, in Jamaica moving down to 4.6, coming from a high of about 9.8% not so long ago. And Cuba having the lowest rate, but some of these data. Nearly two-thirds of the people living with HIV in the Caribbean knew their status, as Carlos presented. So 64% were saying knew their status. I don't know if it means that they currently know their status, because we need to look at how we ensure that we continue to do testing. The new infections are being diagnosed, etc. But again, this is a diverse group. In Jamaica, 81%, Cuba, 87%, but Haiti, 61% of persons who are HIV infected actually knew their status. And so, again, there's a tremendous challenge in testing and diagnosing persons who are HIV infected. And this is going to be interesting when you look at implementing PrEP, because most of the serodiscordant couples, partners are not aware that one person in the relationship is positive. And even when the positive partner knows that he's positive, he's not disclosing. We have seen a couple of studies on disclosure, and very few, less than 30% of the people, are in fact disclosing to their partners that they're infected in the Caribbean. So testing among men who have sex with men have been improving, but if the gap is still close to 30% in many countries, and far higher in a number of others. Antigua and Suriname, again, smaller countries with very few, with low population rates, saying that they've tested 99%, but I think we have not tested maybe a half of those who are MSMs in the countries, and a lot of it has to do with the stigma and the discrimination.
Can I just ask a question? No, just a question that made me wonder, because here you see that, that's for male sex workers. Because I don't know, MSM testing, they have Cuba, it's 24% testing, but there, in the slide before it said in Cuba, 89% knew their status among MSM. How can I have 89% know their status and only 24% being tested? Isn't there a discrepancy there? 87%? No, go back, one more. Further, yeah, 87% of people living with HIV know their status, but only 24% of the Senate are tested.
Right, because it's the overall population, not the MSM population. And
expect that MSM make a large percentage of the population.
Not necessarily so in the Caribbean region. I mean, we're seeing that in most of the countries, is the the general population and women who are making up the majority. And in fact, it's a 50-50 between men and women. So female sex workers have made some progress, and we're saying that 64% do their status. Among the MSM, testing varies, but about half of the MSMs have been tested. Again, a little bit, maybe two-thirds of the commercial sex workers have been tested. And the persons who have been tested and know their status, about a half of them are, in fact, half of the persons living with HIV are, in fact, on treatment within the Caribbean. But when you look at this, this actually equates to about 8% of those who know their status being on treatment. But this figure is actually very deceptive, because I think it represents ever started ARVs. Because when we go to each clinic and do an assessment, we find that up to 30% of the patients who are registered as patients in the clinic are in fact inactive and have not been to the clinic for months or even a year. Percentage of persons on treatment who are virally suppressed, again, of those who are on treatment, 67% are virally suppressed. But if you look at overall HIV-infected population, we're seeing that only 30% of the overall population is in fact virally suppressed, which gives you a picture of the community viral loads that are out there, and the fact that if you want to use viral suppression rates as a marker for breaking the back of the epidemic and reduction in transmission rates, we can see that we're nowhere near to achieving these kinds of rates that we need to get to meet 1990, but also to prevent transmission, as the studies are showing. So at a community level, at an individual level, we can see that viral suppression and will reduce the risk of transmission from one individual to the next. But at a community level, at a 34% viral load suppression rate, we're not going to be making the impact that we want. Overall, though, we have seen marked increase in persons being placed on antiretroviral drugs up until 2016. A lot of this has been funded by external partners, the Global Fund, PEPFAR, and a lot of this is challenged now because of the Caribbean being ranked as upper middle income countries. And in fact, we have made marked progress in reducing the death rate, but in some countries, for example, like Jamaica, we have seen slight upticks in the death rates as well, and persons are still presenting very late with AIDS defining symptoms. So where are we in terms of meeting the 2020 the targets? Well, we still have a gap in persons being diagnosed. They're saying 64% know their status, so we have another 81,000 persons to be diagnosed. It doesn't sound like a lot in the scheme of things, but the barriers that exist in the Caribbean in terms of the structural healthcare barriers and the stigma and discrimination environment makes it challenging to move this forward. So this is a great issue that we need to work on. When you look at persons on treatment, we say half of them are in treatment, 92,000 persons more need to be treated, and the community viral load is still very high. So with that, I will give you a little bit about AHF, because while you're seeing a number of the partners pulling out of the Caribbean, AHF is now trying to scale up its work in the Caribbean. And over the last 2 or 3 years, AHF has been in a number of the Caribbean countries. So in Jamaica, we've been trying to promote test and treat. And we have actually started a process in Jamaica of auditing all of the treatment sites and seeing what identified persons who are actually HIV, who are on treatment versus those who are inactive or loss of follow-up. And as I said, about 30% of the clients who are registered in the clinic thought to be coming and active are in fact inactive, not necessarily on their treatment, and are not visiting the clinics regularly. In Jamaica, in terms of diversity of care as well, we have implemented our own standalone HIV treatment center in Jamaica. We call it a wellness center. And this opened last month, and we are now seeing we have close to 40 patients, HIV-infected patients, in treatment in the clinic within 6 weeks. And these are new patients. In Haiti, again, we have a presence. We are working in 13 prisons in Haiti and trying to expand testing. We have massive testing events. We are using mobile outreach And we actually have AHF clinic in Haiti as well, providing care as another an alternative to the government system and some of the other places that exist. In the Dominican Republic, so we are in the four major Caribbean countries that are impacted. We are again in the prisons, but we're also working with a number of local NGOs and some of the government clinics to provide care. But I wanted to present this in particular because in this particular prison, La Victoria Prison, we're seeing where conjugal visits are allowed, for example, and we have started a program now to test the visitors entering the prison, not just the prisoners, but the visitors, and we're in 3 months after testing about 2,448 persons, we found 41 positive persons who were entering the prison at one day or the other to provide services. And also, we have just started a project in Trinidad and Tobago, working with the Family Planning Association of Trinidad and Tobago to provide prevention services, testing services, but we hope to move forward to have an alternative clinic in Trinidad for patients, high risk and vulnerable groups to access care. So in summary, in the Caribbean, the epidemic is much different from it is in Latin America, and we need to keep that in mind when we're always together as a group, but we need to keep in mind the diversity between the two epidemics. There's constant decline of AIDS-related deaths, so we have made that progress. We're on track in preventing mother to child transmission, improving testing coverage for key populations, MSM and female sex workers, but we're still not testing the numbers of these persons that we need to. New infections are not declining, and this is a worrying signal. While new infections are declining in many other areas, in the main, new infections are not declining in the Caribbean. And in fact, it's increasing among men and in young people. Many countries are not yet practicing test and treat, though they have all signed on to test and treat, and in words and theory say we are doing test and treat. Many countries are still holding patients until CD4 counts are dropping before they actually start on treatment. Treatment coverage therefore remains low, and many who have started treatment have been lost to follow-up, and maybe about 30% of the patients who are saying are on antiretroviral drugs are in fact inactive patients. Viral suppression rates are inadequate to break the chain of transmission, and more needs to be done to reach and test young people. So in general, because of the loss of funding, et cetera, in the Caribbean, general population funding and funding towards interventions among youth and young people have in fact dried up, and many governments who should have been putting that money forward have not done so, and hence those programs have actually fallen down. We're seeing a resurgence in attention to young people, and we hope that will continue. So, in summary, the Caribbean is still challenged in terms of the HIV epidemic and putting persons on treatment. We still have issues with stigma and discrimination. We are making some progress. We have seen what has happened in Belize and now Trinidad and many of the other countries I hope will follow suit. And we have to now consider this in the context of PrEP. And we fully agree and recognize that PrEP is a valid intervention, and a mix of prevention services need to be provided. But keep in mind that we're far from where we need to be in terms of providing treatment and care. Thank you.
Muchas gracias. Thank you very much. Les recuerdo que las presentaciones van a estar en línea, así que no se alarmen por tomar notas. Y tenemos unos 5 minutos para preguntas. ¿Alguna pregunta para nuestros ponentes?